My name's Debbie with Campaign for Liberty. Our mission is to promote and defend the great American principles of individual liberty, sound money, free markets, a limited constitutional government, and peace. This year, 2015, has probably been one of the most devastating seasons for wildfire that I have had to live through. I found myself once again packing up my house and moving all my treasures down to storage because I didn't know if the fire that was moving at several miles a day, I think it started one day in Canyonville, which is about, 20, 40 miles from us. And then within a day, it was south of Tiller, which is only 20 miles from us. So it was burning so fast that I was afraid not to make our move at that time. Today we're going to talk about the root causes, the solutions, the possible solutions. And I hope everybody gets an opportunity to check out everything in the back here. For whatever you can donate, you can take something. There's t-shirts, there's books, there's videos. It really helps to make these kind of things happen because all the money that goes out for travel and time is out of our own pockets. So feel free to browse back there and see what's available, and hopefully you'll find something that you like. I'm going to start by introducing Elaine, but I want you to know that we're going to go. Elaine wrote a beautiful letter to the editor of her local paper. She went through the fire. She's fighting a battle up north now. And then we've got Sam and Tad, who are also from the same areas. And we've got Blair, who is going to talk about our responsibility as homeowners, too, because we can talk about everything else in the world, but as homeowners, we have a certain amount of responsibility also. And then we've got Kevin, who's going to come up after Dennis, who's got a big chunk of time to tell you about the possible solutions and the root causes of everything that's going on right now. So I'm going to turn this over to Elaine. And thank you very much for coming, Elaine. I really appreciate it.
And I'm not very good with microphones, but I'm from Grant County, Oregon, as is Sam and Tad that are here with me. We had a 100,000-plus acre fire that just about burned out two towns. They managed to stop it pretty close to the town, and these guys here were instrumental in doing that. And when I wrote this letter, at that time we knew that 39 homes had burned. That was, and since after I wrote the letter, I think it was a whole week later, the fire was still going and was still raging, and it burnt more homes, and I'm not sure what the total is. It's in the 40s. Plus cabins. There was quite a few people that had cabins, and so we have it, and we have it in our county. We have 7,000 citizens and just a few towns that are just kind of drying up and blowing away because we haven't been able to use the forests. We have a wilderness area, which is one of the fires that started in the wilderness area. And when the fire started, there was two different fires. They were 7 miles apart. There was paved roads in between, and they could have been stopped, is what many of us believe. So anyway, so I got fired up and wrote this letter to the editor. In the past 20 plus years, the BLM and U.S. Forest Service have been reducing cattle grazing and logging on federal lands to protect various supposedly endangered species, spotted owl, bull trout, sage grouse, and so forth. How many of these endangered species managed to live through this current inferno? We have seen photos of deer burned alive and reports of herds of elk and wild horses that didn't manage to escape the fires. The article in the Blue Mountain Eagle, Forest Service Defends the Canyon Creek Response, provides more questions than answers, in my opinion. The Canyon Creek Complex was originally two separate fires miles apart and separated by Highway 395 and paved county roads. The newspaper account lumps both the Berry Creek and the Mason Spring fires together and lists all of the heavy equipment, air tankers deployed, as if they were not two separate fires, with no mention of the exact timeline for initial attack on each separate fire, even though they remained individual fires until Friday, August 14th. The Berry Creek fire reportedly was ignited first by lightning in the Strawberry Wilderness area in the early morning hours on August 12th. What equipment and or tankers, helicopters, and so forth were assigned to the Berry Creek fire in the Strawberry Wilderness and when? The article also supplies us with the information that Beverlyn, he's our forest supervisor, signed off on an order granting special permission to use chainsaws for fire suppression in the wilderness area. Just when was this order signed? After the fire was already out of control or was merged with the Mason Creek fire? The Mason Creek fire was reportedly contained by Wednesday afternoon. Was there a crew and water tenders there when the Mason Spring fire jumped the containment lines? Why was this fire only contained and not put out? The Eagle reported last week that during the informational meetings there were whispers blaming the homeowners for their loss because they didn't maintain a dispensable space around their homes. What if the Malheur National Forest had been managed to maintain a defensible space between the forest boundary and private land? I do know in my small community we have at least 39 homes burned, families lost a lifetime of memories, and are left with rebuilding their lives because of mismanagement by federal entities. These homeowners and the community deserve complete disclosure. Now, after I wrote that letter, in fact, when the day the letter came out in the newspaper, it was basically kind of answered in advance by some Forest Service person from out of the area. And then since then, it just seems like anytime we put something in the paper, they have a Forest Service person that answers it, and not in the next week's paper, but somebody is getting the information ahead of time to answer it. And we've got to stop this control of information. And and the one gal I know that, and she lost her home. And they fought hard to keep the fire from overrunning them. They would have had everything fairly well kept. And she was accused of, she said something about her little daughter, the loss to her 4 or 5 year old daughter. And someone cruelly said, this was less than a week after they'd lost their home, said that, well, you didn't maintain a defensible space. They didn't even know whether she had or not. And it told her that her daughter lost a home because of what she did, not because, you know, trying to deflect the criticism of the federal agencies. So I've got with me these two gentlemen here, Sam Palmer, and Tad, and they both manage their own timber. They lost homes themselves because they owned the timberland, and they have some thoughts on solutions, and they can also tell you the harrowing tale of what happened to them as they were trying to save the neighbors' homes and their own homes. And you know, one thing I guess we can feel blessed about is that no one did lose their lives in this fire. As fast as it went through there, that's a miracle, right? Okay.
This type of fire was 100% preventable. I've begged the U.S. Forest Service, our local officials, that these projects that they were going to do at the head of this would not stop this from happening. I told them this would happen, and I've been telling them we can make this to where it does not happen, and they could have. Unfortunately, what I told them fell on deaf ears. My name's Tad Halp. I've logged for about 35 years. I've done just about every job there is, slash treatments, timber falling, skidding, etc. I've helicopter logged, line logged, cat skidder logged, and I've managed a lot of private property. If you look in the background, the difference between this green stuff, which is logged and thin timber, and all the stuff in the back is unmanaged timberland managed by the U.S. Forest Service. If it had been managed like this, and logged, thinned, and cleaned up, it would have never ever looked like that. There's virtually nothing alive on the other side of the canyon over there, and all that burnt within an hour. Did the same thing on this side of the canyon, but where it hit private lands that were well managed, the fire laid down. It took a ways for it to lay down, but it went right down to the ground, and as you can see, the trees are still alive. The problem isn't even close to being over. This is just the start of the problems. Now we're going to have massive flooding, and there's two towns down the canyon from this. And if they don't do immediate work on the creek channel, widening it and deepening it, there's going to be probably thousands of people that are affected from the flood. This entire drainage is burned out. It's a very unique drainage. It's enormous. And it goes from 3,000 feet to almost 9,000 feet. And it has a huge snow load area. It's solid rock, as you can see, which will absorb very little water very slowly. Then we'll have to look at if this isn't salvaged, which almost likely this will never be salvaged. All this stuff will fall over, and within a few years you'll have cyanosis growing up through it, and you'll have a way bigger fuel load than when this just burnt. It's time the policies change. We have to quit taking areas on a map and drawing a circle around them and saying we're protecting it with that line on a map, because that doesn't protect anything. All the private landowners in this canyon had their land, at the worst, semi-managed. Most of them had their land manicured, but there wasn't enough area in between the forest, managed by the federal government, or so-called managed by the federal government, and their land for it to slow down. So it nuked them, and a lot of these people lost their homes. We need to learn from this right now. This didn't have to happen at all. As you can see, I've managed this green timber, and I've managed well over 1,000 acres here on my land and on others, adjoining landowners, and it laid the fire to the ground, and they kept it from burning town. If this would have been done all over the federally managed lands, we would have never, ever even had a fire this big in the first place. You just cannot get fires that get this enormous unless you have the fuels there.
I'd like to explain too that it was a whole week later that this fire was still raging, came up over top of the hill and came within 1.5 miles of Prairie City, and they were trying to evacuate people. Prairie City is across a green valley from where that fire was. People had burning embers landing in their yard, and I live quite a ways from town itself, but it scared me. I was putting sprinklers out. I just have dry grazing land around me, and it just was, to me, it's like they're just allowing this. So we need to do something.
Starting about 15 years ago, I warned the county court and the Forest Service that they had this problem, and
And to go back even before that, I spent a lot of years salvaging burnt timber, working on forest fires. I've got probably 15 or 20,000 hours on the ground working in burned out forests. And I paid attention while I was working, and I got a notice in flash floods and floods that people never even knew about. And I also paid attention on the way these fires behave. And so I have a lot of background and I know what fires do. I've never ever seen a fire burn this fast in my life. Nothing even close to it. The stuff across the canyon there, I watched probably somewhere between 5,000 and 7,000 acres burn there in less than an hour. And when it burned out, it sucked that other fire, which was about 10 miles from my house. It sucked it in, and it hit my property at the hottest part of the day with the lowest humidity, between 2 and 3. And it hit my property at over 100 miles an hour. So there is basically no defensible space. This defensible space, if it starts close to you before it gets to head of steam, there may be a defensible space. But once they start making a monster where it's, putting a thunderhead cloud up into the, 50, 60,000 feet into the air and making debris fall miles away from the fire, there is no defensible space. In fact, when the second fire combined and hit my property, it started a spot fire in Canyon City, which is over 5 miles away. And when I broke my leg right before the fire came, so I had to leave, but then I come back because my best friend and my brother's son-in-law, they were trapped at my house. And me and my brother, we decided not to drive up the hill because we thought we probably would have been killed. And I'm glad we didn't, because we probably would have been killed. But the policies of our government, and what really amazes me is 8 years prior to this, I had all the head brass from the Forest Service, plus our county court, state forestry. I took them on a tour, and I took them up on my property where we could overlook all this wilderness area and up the canyon. And I said, we have to do something with this because a fire's coming. And I figured it was coming out of one of four drainages. I never ever envisioned two fires feeding each other, and that's exactly what they did. That was a way worse scenario. And we went out and looked at some of their broadcast burning they're doing, and I said, you guys got to stop this. It's just, you're actually making more fuel with this broadcast burning because you kill and damage so much timber that it later on, it dies and then loads the ground even more. And then we looked at some of their stewardship projects. And I go, you're not cutting enough. You have to log it too. You can't just say, I'm going to go cut the little trees and it's going to be fire safe, because it won't. You have to cut some of the big trees, some of the medium-sized trees, some of the smaller trees, and thin it and clean it up. And they just about laughed me under the table. In fact, two of our county commissioners, they said, well, they were just all proud they were going to get all this stewardship going. The fire, not the Berry Creek, but the Mason Springs fire, it got big in their completed stewardship projects. They had already completed it, and that's where it got big. So I was right. It did. I don't want to be right, but that's just, it wasn't enough. It wasn't even close. And then I told them this flood would come, because when I worked out of Boise, salvaging a lot of that ground over there, the people never even knew they had a flood over there because they have flood control dams. The dams caught their floods. And
tell them what it did behind the one dam.
The 96, the Payette River, up above Horseshoe Bend, which they only had part of their drainage burnout. It run flood stage times two. It looked like some special effects out of a movie. And it filled Black Canyon Reservoir with silt. They had to dig it out. But they caught that, it caught that flood. And also the same year, I think it was 96, somewhere in there, they got behind Boise, they have Lucky Peak and there are Rock Lake. Those are huge lakes. Well, they caught the flood there, but they had to put it, they had to release almost all summer long through Boise, and they had to keep the river through Boise almost at flood stage all summer long. So the people never even knew they had a flood, and all that's burned off behind there. So the whole Northwest is in a, we're set up for almost a Katrina type event. If we have a 100-year flood, which usually these 100-year floods, what they call, are over the whole West. They're not just located in one community. All these dams, like on the Columbia and Snake, they'll have to let them off. And downstream places are going to get flooded really bad. Well, that's probably about... Yeah, all these fires, I mean, you have a different timber type. There's different timber types and stuff everywhere. I've cut in Alaska, I've cut in Florida, I've felled timber in Georgia, North Carolina, South Carolina, and in Idaho, California. I've cut all over for Columbia helicopters. All different types of timber, and there's all different types of vegetation, and each place has, you know, it's fuel. Different fuel loads are acceptable. Like here, you would be able to have a lot higher fuel load than like where I live out of John Day. Where I live out of John Day, about 2 tons per acre, which is basically clean land. That's what a forest is capable of surviving a fire. Some of this wilderness here will run over 300 tons per acre. So you can see why it's over 150 times what a forest is able to survive during a fire. And some of the places may as run as high as 500 tons. We have some of the highest fuel loads in the Northwest. It's just incredible. And they're basically not doing anything about it.
You mentioned a stewardship project that apparently didn't work. So can you describe what that stewardship project was?
Their idea, when they call them stewardships, and I would call them poor stewardships, and here's why. A lot of these, what they do is they'll say, we're going to go out and take this area here, and they're taking vast areas. They got the right idea on the areas, but they're going to say, well, we're only going to cut trees that are 12 inches in diameter and smaller. So they're not, I mean, you have big, great big trees dying all over the place, and one of those falls over, you might have 10 tons of fuel in one tree. So that's where the fuel load's coming. It's from the big trees. It's not coming from the little trees. And then they'll log out the little tiny stuff, which basically has no value. They have to subsidize everybody. And they make a socialized, and then they're just causing more socialism is what they're doing by doing this, and then it don't work because there's still too much stuff there. You cut all the little trees in Grant County and you'd still have a forest that's unhealthy and too much fuel load.
With your expertise, what diameter do you think they should go up to be effective in terms of the stewardship?
I'd say you can't have restrictions like that. Think about if you had a herd of cows. You say, well, I'm just gonna harvest the babies. I'm not gonna anything that's medium age or old age. I'm not gonna harvest any of that, or I'm not gonna cull it out. Pretty soon you don't have herd because you've killed off all your young stuff and you've saved back all your old stuff. Well, old stuff dies. I mean, everything living dies. And, I mean, you could apply it to a garden. I mean, if you have big red ripe tomatoes, and you say, I'm not going to harvest those, and that this is exactly what they're doing with our forest. We have, over there, they have a rule, they won't cut anything over 21 inches in diameter. So nothing feasible they're going to cut, but they're going to cut all the stuff that is unfeasible that's young and healthy. And it just, it's insane.
Are you saying then that all the older timber should be cut first and then go back and get the young stuff later?
Well, I wouldn't say. I wouldn't say cut all the older. Our type of timber type over there is predominantly ponderosa pine. You want to keep a mixed age. You want to have older trees, you want to have medium-sized stuff, and you want to have young stuff. You don't want to have all big or all small. I mean, it's this timber type here is completely different. I mean, in every different place, it's different.
No, my father was the crosscut saw guy, and the guy he never had a power saw in his until the last. Probably 3-4 years of his life, but we never had the fires around here that they're having. And there's logs going out of here like crazy.
See, there's no real logs going out of the National Forest over there at all. It's all little tiny stuff, and they're leaving all the big old stuff, and a lot of that is. In fact, I've seen some of these stewardships before they were done. You would just have hundreds and hundreds of big trees die while they were in there doing the stewardship there, and they can't cut them. I mean, it's ridiculous.
You'll see a log truck go down the road with so many trees on it you can't count it, and you've got to cut several hundred rather than cutting like two. If you cut two big trees, it'd be the equivalent of cutting seven small trees.
And I guess there's two types of fuel in the forest. You have your ground fuels, and then your live standing trees. They're your secondary fuels. When I was talking tonnage, I was talking on primary fuels, which are your ground fuels. And that, around where I live, about 2 tons is about all you can have, or if you get a fire, it's going to kill your timber, and which is 2 tons is clean. I mean, here it's sky high compared, but you have a lot wetter climate here.
Any other questions?
Thank you.
Thank you.
I guess it's my turn. I'm Sam Palmer. I'm also from John Day. I'm actually a registered nurse by trade, and I'm a logger by choice. I've spent many, many years in the woods. I put myself through college working for the U.S. Forest Service on fire crew. I spent over 10 years working fires. I actually used to quit my nursing jobs in the summer because I really enjoyed fighting fire. That being one of the key words, enjoyed fighting fire. In what I call the 10 years that I worked for the Forest Service, I was thinking of reflecting on this the other day. On the Malheur National Forest, I was on one fire that a fire retardant plane was called in, and the fire was probably less than 100 acres. And now you get a fire, you see fire retardant planes flying. I mean, they're like a beehive. I mean, they're going everywhere. They got the small ones now, the seats that they're putting out, the single engine, the air tankers. And I mean, they're spending money. I mean, they're putting resources on it. We never had that, and we never lost fires. I started fighting fires in the early 80s and went into the early 90s. But what I'd like to kind of parallel my program on here and talk about, I'd kind of like to parallel it with medicine. And this is something that I hope I can bring across that you understand. Medicine is a science, and it's also an art. How many people here have ever been to the doctor? How many people have ever had a well exam? So you go in, the doctor says, hey, you're all right. But you know what? I'm going to give you something that's going to hurt you. I'm going to give you this pill, you're going to take it, and it's going to hurt you. It's a prescription for disaster. And the same thing's going on with the policies in our federal government. I'm going to tell you this is okay, but I'm going to burn you out. How many fires have been around here? You guys have fires around here? We just had 110,000 acres on one fire. My business partner and I, we just lost 3 homes. It was probably just due to prayer that I didn't die in that fire. As everybody was running away, I was driving to it. So over the last, 30 years, we've seen, as you said, we didn't see these fires in the past. So what does that tell us? I mean, if you just look at it very simply, this is a prescription for disaster. To me, this has to be intentional. They have to be. If I was giving somebody a medicine out of my emergency room and it was harming them, I'd stop giving them the medicine. We used to give thalidomide to the pregnant women for nausea. We started having birth defects. We don't give it anymore. Now we're having fire after fire after fire, and they're getting bigger and bigger and bigger. You're seeing people die. You're seeing homes and property destroyed. Wouldn't you think you'd learn after the first one or two that something's got to change back? I mean, it's pretty simple math to me. And I'm just looking at it from a nurse's perspective. You know, if what you're doing doesn't work, you better do something else. It's not that hard to figure out. We lost probably, we work. I want to back this up a little bit. We set out with some goals many years ago, and we pretty much work 7 days a week, have for many, many years. We've missed out on our kids' events. We've missed out on family events. We've missed out on vacations because we wanted to set ourselves up for the future, and because we could, and a lot of that was our choice. Between the three of us, we lost probably in the neighborhood of $1.5 million in about 15 minutes that we've worked many, many, many years to establish. Pretty bitter pill to swallow when you work that hard. Now, we're young enough, we're in our 50s, we'll recover. We'll make something good out of this bad. Our neighbors, some of them in their late 70s, late 80s, had to choose between buying fire insurance and buying medicine. And guess what they bought? Yeah, they bought medicine. And they lost everything that they had, possessions for their whole lives, all over something that was preventable, all because of failed Forest Service policy. It's time to do something, and it's time to do something for the good. Questions?
What role, if any, should law enforcement, have in mitigating forest fires, especially the sheriff's office?
I don't know that I can speak towards that because I'm not a law enforcement person. I know that our sheriff stands for the people. He's a constitutional sheriff, and he's doing his best with the resources he has and he's being fought tooth and nail by our local, our state, our federal, and our county governments. He's a one-man force. Even his employees fight him. And what it comes down to is, we're on social welfare. We're a community such as this. Our sawmills are closing. Our jobs are going away. Our schools will be reduced. The only way we get money is if the government gives it to us. And all our county officials are used to sucking on the tit, and they don't want to give it up. And we're paying for it.
I'd like to say one other thing. During this time, and I think it was right before the fire came up over the top and headed towards Prairie City, another fire had started up behind Prairie City. And due to the efforts by the local fire department, they get right on it. They put that out. It didn't, I can't remember how big it got, but they just got right on it. And I think the sheriff's office had something to do with that also, because they could see that, you know, we were going to lose communities if we didn't, and we luckily didn't lose the community, but we're losing it daily. Our schools are dwindling down to nothing because people have to move out because they don't have a job. And these stewardship contracts in our area, and it's federal government money, and the Forest Service gave the whole ball of wax to one contractor, isn't it one? And then he just kind of doles it out to his friends. Yeah, he decides who works and who doesn't, and you either kiss his hind end or you don't work. And that's where we are. That's why, you know, we had thriving communities, thriving schools, and people now a lot of what our county supports itself with, or we have a mental health facility. We have also a facility, and these are government money also, a facility that to take care of people that are mentally challenged, and they bring them in from other areas. And actually, and I've got to say this, we maybe have a few in our community, and we lived with them and loved them, and they're part of the community, but we have to import them to support, to make family jobs, and that's sad.
Thank you, Elaine, Tad, and Sam. Yeah. That's awesome. Unfortunately, you had to go through that. Nobody should ever have to go through that. And all your points you've hit very well. And I'm going to talk a little bit about wildfire and are you prepared. And I've got some handouts that are in the back, but also two, I was going to give you a little bit of history of the Butte Falls Volunteer Fire Department. I started, I think, in 1990. So I started out as a boot, as we call it, and worked up through the ranks, fought wildfire for the Forest Service, learned how to fight structure fires. You know, at one point you know, our motto was we've never lost the foundation. But that's changed over the years through a lot of good training, a lot of good community support. And I kind of want to get into how, when we get dispatched to a wildland fire, and also within this community here, even though there's not really wildland fire type of situations where you have the heavy timber and stuff, it's mostly kind of thinned around. But there's also, we've had some problems with a house fire recently, I think a year ago, late September, where we had a structure fire, and it was so close to another house that that we weren't sure what we're gonna have to do. By the time we got there, I think our dispatch time from the fire hall just right uptown, right over to this house, was like 3 or 4 minutes. By the time we got there, it was fully involved. But it was, we were concerned with the houses adjacent to it, of the firewood stack next to them, or the pile of wood out front, or the cars that might be registered that aren't running, you know. So one of our deals when we show up to a house, or if we get dispatched out of town, luckily, like I said, we have a great community. We have a 2,500 gallon water tender that 80% of that water tender was donated by local loggers and different people. Anything from tires to the tank to the paint jobs, everything. It's a beautiful piece of equipment. We've also had to depend on federal grants. You know, we had a 1964. It was bought brand new back in 64, of course. And we were finally able to replace that as our first out engine. Ordered, we were able to get a grant and send it out here from Florida, of all places. But as a firefighter, coming from a firefighter standpoint, and not only that, from an incident commander or the assistant chief, the guy who has to make the calls out there in order to make the right decisions, there's three things that we provide our tactics on. Tactics are how we are going to attack something. Tactics, whether it's how you're going to attack a unit that's 45% slope, whether it's got bluffs or ridges. It's life comes first, then it's property, and then it's resources. So oftentimes, luckily, we haven't had a big, what they call a conflagration, or a very large wildfire around here. We do have potential. I do believe this summer, while some of the fires were going on around here, Rustler Peak, which is 6,000 foot elevation, recorded like 96 degrees with like 9% humidity. On average, back years ago, we'd be looking at mid-80s, 20% humidity. You know, so when people come here from other areas and fight fire, they go, oh, 20%, that isn't that much. But it's, for here, it's, yeah, hold on to your tail feathers because things are going to get interesting. So with that, what we do is we go into an area, and if there's a lot of houses, we have to triage, what I call triage, which is much like paramedic triaging patients on a car accident. You know, well, you know, this one's got a broken arm, but it's not bleeding. We can kind of put them off to the side. This one over here is unconscious, not breathing, and, you know, it's ugly. So we need to get them in the helicopter first. We do the same thing with wildfire. We drive up a driveway. We start looking at places. Sometimes we already know the conditions of those areas, because oftentimes people come and ask us and say, hey, you got time? I know you're a volunteer. You do this for free. You do this for fun. This is your hobby. I said, well, yeah, I can find time. My wife will let me come out of the house once in a while if I don't have my too big a laundry list. But we already pre-plan and we already know. So oftentimes we might draw a line somewhere. We might say, hey, these three houses back here hasn't done anything. You know, they didn't have enough respect, maybe it's not the right word, for themselves nor their neighbors. So we've got to draw the line right here. We can protect this house. We can either, you know, use the water tender and we can water it down, or, you know, sometimes we fight fire with fire. But I guess what I'm getting at is we all need to begin with our personal responsibility. I have plenty of these handouts back there, and Deb is more than welcome to pack them along, whatever's extra. But, you know, we need to be prepared. It gives you all sorts of good information here. There's also some websites on the back. There's a Facebook page that I do believe is called Preventive Wildfire Maintenance. It has to do with Jackson County and Josephine County. And it's a group of people that are getting together to form work groups and get together and tools, people, to come together and help each other thin their land and clear debris away from houses and different things. So anyway, like I said, those pamphlets are back there. All that information's in there. We're at the fire department. We meet every Tuesday at 6:30. If you hear the bell or the air raid siren before that, it usually means that we have something going on, but we meet every Tuesday at 6:30. And, you know, I just want to thank you for your time, and I hope I've given you enough information to better your property and to help you prevent wildfire. Because if it gets into a situation where you have 100-mile-an-hour winds, I mean, you could have a 35-acre clear cut around your house, and that's not going to do you a bit of good because those embers travel. We're talking embers as big as your fist or bigger, and they're raging hot. And you know, so we need to start with ourselves.
If things aren't working, don't you think it's time to revisit the issue? The assumption there is things aren't going to plan. I would like to think in a different light. What if things are going to plan, right? That's the side of the equation that we have to be willing to recognize. What if, and this is a weird one, right? This is really weird. What if everything is working just right? What if this is purposeful? And now all of a sudden you start to get uneasy in your chair and you think, but yeah, we're Americans, we live in a republic, we've got the Constitution, we've got our Bill of Rights. And you see those are getting shoveled under 6 feet every single day. Tell me what rights a baby in the womb has. None. Body parts. Cash is king. Ready? It's for sale. Tell me what rights you have to keep anybody from perusing your cell phone, listening to your conversations, watching your computer, and you know, sifting through your email. None. That's the point. None. A while ago, it was actually a couple of years ago, I took my wife is Diane, by the way. My name's Dennis. This is Diane. She's my wife. We have two kids. Danny is our daughter in Denver. They're 31 and 30, and they're married and have, you know, spouses, and we have one grandchild. And I decided I wanted to take everybody to Front Sight down in Nevada for some firearms training. So the three girls have 9mm. The three guys have 40 caliber. We were supposed to take about 1,000 rounds each for a 4-day event. So I ordered 6,000 rounds of ammo. And at the time I was a county commissioner, and I'm taking all six of us to Front Sight, and I ordered 6,000 rounds of ammo. I'm a county commissioner in Klamath County, and I've got a good relationship with most everybody, but the UPS guy brings his little hand truck and puts it on the porch, and he says, Commissioner, is there something you want to tell me about your days at the office? Colleen Roberts probably knows exactly what that feels like, you know. The important part about running through some of these slides and whatever is just to think about liberty. How many of you are from Butte Falls area? How many of you, this is your hometown? Okay, tell me what's the most sacred role for government? It's on the community center. Come on. Anybody know what it is? You guys walk by that daily and nobody knows what it is? What is it, Karen?
City Hall?
Yeah, the City Hall.
Serve and protect.
Oh, man.
Yeah, they just put the new sign back up, too.
Yeah, they just put that sign out there. What that sign above the city hall says is, it's a quote from Thomas Jefferson, the most sacred responsibility is to provide equal access to justice with impartiality to everyone, right? In other words, everyone gets justice without partiality. Everyone has access to the same system. We are all created equal in the eyes of what? Not only our Lord, right? Not only God, but because our institutions were developed with this biblical worldview, we're saying all of these institutions support our belief system that says no man is higher than any other man. We're all equal. These are important ideas that have to be pumping through your blood. If they're not pumping through your blood, we will lose the republic that we've been given. We've been given it by blood, sweat, and tears, by fortunes, and by the hard work and lives of other people who are before us in history. And today's our day to pick up the mantle. Today's our day to run to the battle, not run from the battle. So the item that I wanted to present today, that I titled it SHAME, and it was just a little acronym I made up out of spoiled habitat, air, mountains, and economy, because the public Forest Service policy is shameful. It does nothing but spoil the beauty that we see around us. It does nothing but spoil habitat and watershed. And there, you had a couple of photos in your YouTube video where there was, you know, bodies and dead mammals, dead fowl, waterfowl, fish. When the flooding happens, the fish are going to get, you know, destroyed as well. And so you have watersheds. You've got forest land, you've got all of the animals that you and I not only enjoy, but consume. And all of these are getting devastated. And think about the tragedy that will happen over time as this goes on and on and on. So I thought it was worthwhile to look at this shameful attitude that's happening in the public service. And the most important facet that you need to remember is this idea that men are all equal. And if you have a biblical worldview running around in your brain, you realize we are also all fallen. We've got different gifts. We're built differently. I'm a little narrow. You're not quite as narrow as I am. I got a little bit more. It's not that I'm better, he's better, I'm smaller, he's bigger. That's not the issue. The point is we're created as equals. We're equals, but we have different talents. We have different gifts. We excel in different ways. Some guys are better at being electricians than other guys. This isn't rocket science. Some guys can paint a buck like you've never seen. Some guys think it comes out of your wallet and you put it on the table when you want to buy a soda, right? We carry these different attributes around in our soul, and these are what we've been given the opportunity to utilize. When we go to utilize those gifts, those talents, that intellect, that skill, we are now using those things to further our family's interest, our own private interest, our business interest, and the end result, according to Adam Smith in The Wealth of Nations, the end result is a community. Because all of a sudden there's a guy who can grow corn and another guy who can grow tomatoes and someone else who can, what, change tires, fix a carburetor, sharpen a chainsaw better than you can. You ought to see my chainsaw. I'm right-handed. I'm always wearing out the teeth with my right-hand filing because I'm, you know, just going like crazy. You guys as loggers know this. My little old puny weak left hand is hard, you know, the teeth are about that long on that side of the chain, and the teeth on the other side are about this long. And I wish that I had a neighbor who would say, let me pitch in, you fix my computer. I've been in software all my life. I've been a software engineer. I do work for Gerald Wynn currently. I was a county commissioner. I was a general contractor. I have skills that a lot of you don't have. You all have skills that I don't have. There's nothing new under the sun. We recognize this. We know it. We need to start using that to build vibrant communities. In questions of power, let no more be heard of confidence in man, but bind him down. Chain him. Bind him down from mischief by the chains of the Constitution. If you allow men to gain positions of power, whether it's county commissioner or governor or president or House of Representatives member, senator, I don't care. Actually, water board member, school board member. All of these individuals need to be bound, chained up by the Constitution. Because if you allow them to do what they think might be a good thing to do, you'll suffer the consequences because they're going to take your liberty right out from under you. Ted had a couple of great examples. I want you to remember these examples. He had two illustrations that were beautiful. One is the tomato illustration, and the other one's the herd of cattle illustration. Can you imagine how the stewardship model has been warped across our land and forest policy by thinking that because it's grown and it's big and it's beautiful and it's healthy today and it's gorgeous red, we're going to leave it there. We're going to leave that there and just watch it. Watch it what? Old things die. I hate to tell you guys, but old things die. Sorry, Colleen. It's okay, yeah. It's a beautiful illustration, but because what we should be doing is harvesting that when it's appropriate, using our knowledge of stewardship, our wisdom, our understanding of natural law, and not harvesting body parts. I've got to get you off the hook there, otherwise it's going to sound like, you know, instead of going into the grave, you'd be Soylent Green. But we've got to use this idea for harvesting this productive asset that is not created equal. It is not human life. Human life is special. Human life is above the rest. And those tomatoes should get harvested, as well as corn, as well as soybeans, as well as green beans and you know, sweet peas and forest products. We should be harvesting timber appropriately. One of the questions was, you want to cut all the old things? And then the next example was, no, you don't do that to your cattle herd. You don't cut your cattle herd. You don't cull the herd by everybody being at this certain age, whack, the game's over. You pay attention to their attributes, to the gifts that they have, to the talents they have. You may keep that bull for 15 years because of the attributes he's passing on. You may want to keep that tree in the forest because of the productive value that the offspring from that lineage brings to your landscape. Maybe that tree, and I've got several of them on my place, you know what? They just need to be taken out. It's time to get some other genealogy growing on this landscape that can survive in this rocky soil, can survive in this terrain, can survive with this rainfall, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So stewardship has been turned upside down by an environmental movement that doesn't have a biblical worldview of stewardship. Their worldview of stewardship says, leave it alone, don't touch it, man is evil, let it survive in the chaos of randomness. If you let the forest survive the chaos of randomness, you will see randomness. You will see tragedy time and time again. Walk into some of these forests around here and look around you. They're not handsome. They're not pretty. They're not park-like. Those are ideas that you and I bring to the table, and the current stewardship model that has been pushed on our culture and society says that isn't good. Man's wisdom, man's knowledge, man's understanding of history doesn't count for squat. We believe in randomness, and we believe that randomness is the strong arm of what? The evolutionary mindset, not the creative mindset. I believe in the creative mindset. I believe in creation. Or remember the bind men with the chains of the Constitution. I put this map together because it started very early in our nation, where all of a sudden we've got a little bit of trouble going with the Constitution. You'll recognize these are the original 13 colonies. These are the unanimous states that signed the Declaration of Independence. The Declaration of Independence said, we are no longer pledging allegiance to King George. We are changing our allegiance. We are now going to pledge allegiance to the idea of liberty. We are pledging our allegiance to the idea that God created all men equal, and they have been endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life first, liberty second, and your own pursuits, your own enjoyment, your own energy and risk and reward, and all the other things you do, they belong to you, and nobody can take those from you. Nobody can take risk and reward from you. Nobody can take your life from you. Nobody can take your liberty from you. And if we ever fall prey to the idea that we can just do what we want and we can take your life and your liberty and those free pursuits that you're choosing to engage in, that risk and that reward, if we can actually take those from you, you tell me, what do you have left? So these ideas permeated, and look at how small the original 13 colonies were. How did the federal government get created? The federal government got created by people within states that created a federation of government, this republic, quote unquote. This large entity known as the federal government got created by states. Here's the very first thing that went wrong. This original territory, can you read that territory, the original 13 states ceded by Great Britain? The next area over, the Louisiana Purchase, is in red there because that's the first time we stepped out of bounds from the Constitution. The federal government does not have the right to own massive tracts of land. They do not have the right to own property. This section right here in red is the very first time Thomas Jefferson, a great Republican, by the way, a man who believed in the Bill of Rights and helped create that document and wrote the Kentucky Resolutions and the Virginia Resolutions, all of a sudden we have the federal government purchasing a large swath of land, owning the land, managing the land, and creating what? States. Wait a minute, I thought states created the union. All of a sudden, now we have the federal government creating states. Wait, who's in charge here? Who's the sovereign? Who's responsible? Do you see that as free people, we lost a little bit of understanding there? All of a sudden, the federal government is now creating states. Do what I say, and I'll give you some freedom. Do what I say, and I'll give you some freedom. Go ahead, play along, I'll give you some freedom. this is a very dangerous game, and it happened way back in the beginning, 1803. We're not that old here. And then it happened, and it happened, and it happened. The Oregon Territory is one of many where the federal government was now granting privileges to states. And it's a little backwards. We're so used to it, it's so historical. We don't mind it that much. We are a state, we demand states' rights. And yet the federal government owns and manages all of this land. Wow. 54% of the land is jurisdictionally owned by the federal government. And you and I want to say, wait, it's Oregon's land. It's not your land. And we now all of a sudden we see the quandary we're in. Well, gee, how do we defend that? And you defend that by recognizing the enabling acts of the Constitution, the enabling acts within the Constitution of the state of Oregon say that the federal government will dispose of all of its land holdings within the Oregon state boundary over time. They never said within 10 years or whatever. They said they would do it over time. Let me get my notes here. Because they said they would do it over time, and they did slowly over time, but in 1976, the FLIPMA Act, the Forest Land Policy Management Act, that act changed the goal from disposition of federal lands to retention of federal lands. And it happened in 76. How old were you guys in 76, right? Anybody here not yet born? Anybody here not yet graduated from high school? Oh, Diane, you cheater. Yeah, this happened in our lifetime. All of a sudden, the federal government decided we're no longer going to dispose of the land and give it appropriately to the states. We're going to keep it for ourselves. Except Hawaii was smart enough in 1959 to say, wait a minute, when you create our statehood, we want all our stinking land back now. And the federal government said, okay, here it is. So it's happened within our life too. Everybody here born? So it's happened in our lifetime where the federal government said, you betcha, all this land really does belong to you in your within your state boundaries. And the federal government, that was in 59. In 76, the federal government says, oh, by the way, we didn't like giving all that land back to Hawaii. We're going to keep it. Just thought you'd like to know. We're going to keep it. This has arisen because of misplaced faith. The welfare state is growing because of a misplaced faith. You used to believe our nation was founded on this idea of life and liberty and your own pursuits. Your own happiness was in your own vocation, in your own risk, in your own reward, in your initiative, in your go-get-em attitude. Whatever you could do that you wanted to do, you carried the weight, you carried the burden, you were free to do that. And we've misplaced our faith. Today, we have faith in the federal government. They'll supply your food needs, they'll supply your housing, they'll supply your clothing, they'll pay for all of these things. There's no sense in believing in God's providence when you can believe in the state government. We actually have been fooled into this scheme. We don't think there are soup lines today. No soup lines exist in America. True or false?
False.
Absolutely false. Where's the soup line? It's at every Oregon Trail card is the essential, you know, replacement for the soup line. It doesn't come from your neighbor. It doesn't come from your community. It doesn't come from your effort, your church, your neighborhood, none of that exists anymore, and that's been the destruction of the local community. Where does it come from? It comes from some bureaucrat in some marbled hall sitting in some office in Washington, D.C. And he just signs his name to it and pushes it out the door, and you get the Benny. You don't even have to develop a relationship with your neighbor. You don't need a relationship with your church community, with your neighborhood community, with people who live to the left and right of your front door. This is purposeful destruction of community. We have become dependents. And as we become dependent on this giver of great things, we keep misplacing our faith in our neighbor. We don't trust him anymore. He's a crazy guy. You see that he even has a firearm. What am I going to do with that? And we're also worried about these kinds of things, and we don't even know how to develop relationships. This is the destruction of the world that you and I remember in our childhood. The other thing that's gone on is misdirected education. This poor little guy, look at his face, right? He's kind of cute, and he's puzzled. Doesn't he look puzzled? I grabbed this picture just because I thought he looked puzzled. Actually, why doesn't someone kill the lights? Or is that going to affect your video? Leave the light on. We'll keep video going here. But this guy, in black and white, looks a little, you know, like I'm not sure how this is going to work out. What are we teaching him anyway? By the way, is that a boy or a girl? Go ahead, someone give me a guess. How do you know it's a boy? It is a boy, and your guess is right, and we have this innate ability to determine male and female aside from body parts. Tell me how much longer this child will grow up understanding male and female. When will that disappear from our culture? When will male and female get robbed from our heritage in the same way your land is getting stolen out from under you? It's coming, and it's coming like a steam engine. And you're tied to the tracks, and we're going to bowl you over. The other thing that goes on is we have misused liberty. Liberty is meant to be freedom. Freedom to enjoy your own pursuits. Not freedom to do whatever you think is appropriate. It's license at that point. Every man decides what's right in his own eyes. Can we really create a community when everybody's deciding for themselves what's right and what's wrong? No, you can't create a community out of that kind of environment. The other thing that's going on is we have a change in recognizing how and what work and money and economic resources are. This is this was a giant survey that was taken asking how much money is in your savings account. And this is really interesting. This blue and this green are here. I don't have a savings account, or it's empty. Look at where that, draw your eyeball up through the 50% mark there, and look at how many of these groupings of people's seniors, 65 and over, boomers, 55 to 64, older Gen Xers from 45 up, younger Gen Xers, millennials, young millennials. Look at this 50% of the population that says, I don't have an account, or it has zero in it. Oh my gosh. Why should I save money? The federal government's got my back, right? Social Security will take care of me. I don't have to worry about my own retirement. The minimum balance required is usually like $200, right? Or less than $1,000. And now we're into this, you know, we're into this orange for just the minimum, and we're into this yellow for less than $1,000. Look at where this number is. And look at, worse yet, although these people say, you know, at least I've got $1,000 or something, 80% is in this range somewhere here. Look at what's happening as we go younger and younger up this chart. All of a sudden, we're relying more and more on parents, on government, on local assistance programs, or something. We've misplaced our faith, we've miseducated our children, and we've given them the liberty, the freedom, the license to do as they please with their economic resources. You can spend your money any way you want. It's fine. If it doesn't work out, we'll take care of you. And this is a dramatic change in how we view the world and how we recognize our economic resources. This chart, the next two charts actually show there's very little difference between Republicans and Democrats. This is World War II gross national debt in this brown line. This is what actually happened. So you could ignore this. This is a portion of the chart. We would have been in pretty good shape until 09, and then we went crazy. But right in here from 99 to 0000 would have been okay, except for we took this trajectory, and red and blue doesn't really matter at this point. Democrats, Republicans, they are all spending your money without using any wisdom. They're all getting money out of the printing press with nobody ever having worked for it, nobody having earned it, no investment in productivity or creation of any sort of wealth except for wealth that comes out of the machine. This is a very destructive mindset to have in terms of what do we do with this stuff. Here's the national debt using the debt ceiling. This is the statutory debt limit. And you see Congress raises it and 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 raises it. This only goes to 16 trillion here. How many zeros after for a trillion? Anybody know?
15? 12?
You guys, are you asking me or telling me? How many zeros in a trillion?
Nine.
Nine's only a billion. 12. You're right. 12 zeros. Pencil it out someday. Write down 19,8. 000,000,000, and that's our national debt today. This only goes to 16 trillion, 19.8 trillion, and we don't even think about it. We just read it in the newspaper and we go, oh yeah, can I have another donut? Yeah. At some point, we're going to have to get a handle on this. How many stars in the Milky Way? And you know, you hold your head, you know, oh, it's a lot. 100 million? No. 200 million? No. 500 million? No. 1 billion? Yes. 1 billion? Maybe 5 billion? We don't know. There's a lot of stars in the Milky Way. Even if there were 500 billion, that would only be half a trillion. 500 billion wouldn't even show up down here under Reagan. 500 billion is nothing. And yet when we look at the stars and the cosmos and the universe, we just get starry-eyed with how big a number that is. And we look at it in terms of the budget, and you know, what's 19.8 trillion?
Well, we may care, but we feel helpless anyway to affect any change.
Yeah, so...
So I just try and ignore it.
So how many of you vote for ignoring it? Right?
I mean, you know it's there, but what can you do? What can you do?
Yeah, well, I'm glad you came today, Diane. What can you do, right? And where does it go? This part right here will start to make all of us squirmy, whatever the word might be. Medicare, Medicaid, Social Security, 49% of the budget goes to those two programs. Two programs. No investment in those programs, by the way. There's not any infrastructure being built. There's no investment being made. There's no return on investment. If I were to join some enterprise, let's say we're going to create a little logging enterprise, and we would buy some acreage that's got timber on it, and we would harvest and sell that timber, and we would get profit, and we would take that profit and buy other land, and then we'd use that land to generate more profit, to hire more guys, to buy more machinery, whatever it was we happened to need, and we would generate return on the investment. Tell me what we're doing to generate return on all of your Social Security payments, all of your withholdings, all the FICA, all the SDI, all the things that you're throwing at the federal government. What is the federal government doing with that money to generate wealth for the next guy in line? Does anybody know the answer? It's easy. It's a goose egg. Zero. They're not investing it. They're taking your money and they're paying it right out the back door. There's not anything productive being done with those resources. They just come in the front door and they go out the back door. And at some point, we're going to have to kind of hold our heads and say, holy cow, how does this work? Here's how it works. We don't have any kids in here. Let's say a child was born right here in 2014. So he's a little one-year-old today. That's sweet. He's so cute. Look at him. He's got that perplexed look on his face because by the time he reaches 18 years old, he will own $90,000. Now remember, he just got out of high school. He got out of high school around, 17 and a half? He's not even really a productive member of society yet. And he owes $90,000 to the pool. And by the time he reaches 24, he'll owe $142,000 to the pool. And you're going to hope that that little grandchild can afford a home by the time he's 24. How's he going to pull this off? What will a home cost him when he's 24? $100,000, $150,000, $200,000? And he owes $142,000. And you're wishing him, you know, a better life than the life you and I had. You see, this is an economic impossibility. It's just not going to happen. Here's a quote from 1776. We are running the next generation into debt. We ought to do the work of it. Otherwise, we use them meanly and pitifully. That is as true today as it was then, as it was during biblical times. The borrower will become the lender's... The borrower will become the lender's slave. You can't escape these kinds of things. They're part of the world we live in. The modern theory of perpetuation of debt has drenched the earth with blood and crushed its inhabitants under burdens ever accumulating. Greater and greater burdens are causing this tragedy. The federal government is the one doing this to your children and my children and your grandchildren and my grandchildren. The federal government is doing this. And don't mistakenly think, gee, they ought to fix it. If they were good guys, they would fix it. If they saw problems with their policy, they would change their policy. Guess what? They don't see problems with the policies that they've implemented. What are we going to do? How do we stop this machine? It's a little bit like if you kind of think of a World War II scene, you've got this tank, and we put a little robot driver in it, and it's just kind of barreling. It's strong enough, it'll go down that block, through that house, through the next house, through the next house, through the high school fence, out the other side, and through all the houses over there on the other side of the high school. It's just following Main Street, right? That's what tanks do. They follow Main Street because somebody programmed them to follow Main Street. And it's bulldozing house after house after house after house. And we wonder, how do we stop this machine? Does this machine care? No, the machine doesn't care. It's programmed to do what it's going to do, and it's doing it quite efficiently. Our lives are in the path. Main Street is in the path of this machine. How do we get it to stop? Here's another quote, 1788. The powers delegated by the proposed Constitution, it wasn't a Constitution yet, of the federal government are few and defined. Those which are to remain in state governments are numerous and indefinite. When will we demand that our state governments get our rights back? State governments have all the power, numerous and indefinite. This is actually even more than the 19 trillion worth of power here. This is indefinite. This is more stars than you can even imagine. Indefinite, numerous, certainly, indefinite, beyond infinity. The federal government's powers are few. They're enumerated. There's only 18 of them, and they're well defined. But we've lost our constitutional footing. We've lost the idea that this document is supposed to restrict government and that we are supposed to be able to exercise our freedom with unlimited bounds. Res publica, the idea of res publica, a republic, that was a restriction on the public domain that was government in government hands. This is a picture. Anybody know what this might look like? What is this thing? Can you tell?
Torpedo.
Very good. It's a torpedo. It's an ADCAP Mark 48 torpedo. This fish is long. It's 19 feet long, 3 feet in diameter. Wow. That's bigger than they were, you know, last time I saw... what's that? Torpedo, PT-109 is the book and movie I was thinking of. They weren't firing these off of a PT boat during World War II. So Mark 48 torpedo, 19 feet long, 3 feet in diameter. It started service in 1988. I'm showing this slide because in 1984, 85, 86, and 87, I was part of the ADCAP torpedo program. And what we were doing was at Hughes Aircraft, and we had a contract to help design and build this thing. And what I was responsible for was, no, I wasn't a Navy guy, and I wasn't blowing things up, and I wasn't packing them with their tonnage of munitions. I was responsible for designing and developing a database that would manage as designed, from as built, from as deployed. So remember, when it's this large of a device and it's got to maintain its balance and it's got to get its 10 miles of thrust out and it's got to be able to find its target in 10 miles of open ocean, are you kidding me? You've got to not only have the engineers think this through and design it, you've also got to have the men who screw this puppy together do it correctly and not shift pieces and parts around, because it'll never perform if you don't build it according to the design. Does that make sense? Your lawnmower won't work either if you don't put it together according to the design. That's why people have such trouble with IKEA furniture. Right? It looks easy. You bring it home, you flip open the piece of paper and you stare at it and you go, does this go here? You know, and you go, zzz, 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 and you put it together and then you go, that don't look right. You know, gee, this table don't quite look right. I can't tell what's wrong, but something's not right. You've got to follow the design. That's what I was responsible for. Making sure this thing got assembled. This is the design for the federal government. This is the design for a republic. The federal government is this little teeny piece of the pie. State governments, local governments, citizens are the massive weight of how this thing was designed. And this is before corruption, BC, right? This is unfortunately what we see today. You and I are the little peons down here at the bottom. We no longer recognize how it was designed. We have a federal government that is crushing state governments, that are killing local governments, and citizens are supposed to pay for all of the goodies that are up above them. Unfortunately, this system just won't survive. It can't. It will collapse, it will fall apart, it does not have the economic fortitude to survive. And so what we have to do is figure out how do we, the people, get our rights back and put that kid in the closet, right? The kid in the closet that I'm referring to is this little guy here who's carrying his Fed t-shirt. Fed's generating all the money. This kid thinks he's a hotshot, and he's telling everybody else what to do. And we've got to figure out how to put him back in his room and keep him there. After all, he's supposed to be the little squirt in the family, and all of a sudden he's running the show. And that's what you and I are charged with. How do we get our government back? What's the solution? It's really a funding problem. And there are only a couple of ways out of here. We tax ourselves. How many of you have seen maybe a bond measure come through the community because the high school needed something? Any bond measures like that show up in Butte Falls?
Big ones.
Okay. How about the library needs something? So a bond measure for the library. The fire department needs something, a bond measure for the fire department. You know, over and over and over again in our neighborhood, they're trying to come up with a trapper levy. And because the federal government, the trapper is an employee of the U.S. Department of Agriculture. The federal government quit paying his salary about 10 years ago. So the State Department of Fish and Wildlife picked up his salary. The state said, we can't afford that bloke anymore. So they pushed it onto county government. County government's been supporting it now for 6 years or so. I finally said, no, we've had enough. We're not putting up with it anymore. But all of the farmers and ranchers who, like the taxpayer, picking up the tab for the trapper who's protecting their sheep, they, like the taxpayer, footing the bill. So now they're putting a levy on the ballot that says, won't taxpayers please support our trapper? Trappers are so important to our community. It's for the good of the community. It will protect your children and your livestock, and it's good for a community. Notice what's happened again. We've lost the language battle. Your community came first. You are your community. You guys get your community from your neighbors and your neighborhood and the homes to the left and right of you. You don't get community by throwing money in a barrel. You get community by working together, by trapping together, by using your skill sets together. That's how you develop community. You do not develop community by taking a gimme from the USDA, because the USDA is still responsible for licensing the men and women who become trappers in your county. Oops, wait a minute. If I'm paying his salary, don't I get to tell him what to do? Nope, you don't. Federal government still has control. They're simply milking you for the economic resources. Tax yourself then, go ahead. Hey, this is even better. Tax your neighbor. He'll not even notice. That's what keeps happening over and over and over again. Tax those menthol cigarettes. The menthol cigarettes sales won't even bother any of us because we don't smoke menthol smokes, do we? No, tax them. That went on about 4 years ago. And you and I didn't even notice, did we? Tax lottery winnings. You and I never even noticed. Tax somebody, just not me, please. How about your offspring, right? Tax the kids. They'll never even notice. The kid born in 2014, he doesn't know that coming out of the womb, he's got $24,000 of debt in his kitty. He doesn't know. He didn't sign up and say, Mom, have me get born today, because today my debt will only be $32,478, and tomorrow it'll be $39,432. The next generation doesn't even know what we have in store for them, and we're destroying their lives by consuming their productivity, by putting them into the bowels of slavery. Tell me that verse again. The borrower will become the lender's slave. And we're destining the next generation to slavery by printing this economic resource. How do you make productivity so free and easy that it just comes off of a machine? Can you do that? Who thinks actually you can really do that? I don't think you can do that. Be not intimidated, nor suffer yourselves to be wheedled. There's a good word for you. Wheedled out of your liberties by any pretense of politeness, delicacy, or decency. These are but three different names for hypocrisy, chicanery, and cowardice. This is an important slide right here. This is 1765, and this is a slide you should remember. It's the decent thing to do. It's the polite thing to do. It's the delicate subject matter that makes me want to, you know, just kind of withdraw my complaint. You know, a good example of this decent and delicate and, you know, polite is Bruce Jenner. All of you were alive and all saw him as a man win the gold medal for the decathlon, right? You are all familiar that he fathered, and I choose my words carefully, he fathered six different children, right? So tell me how it is today we have so much trouble calling him Bruce. His name is Caitlin. Her name is Caitlin. It's decent. It's delicate subject matter. I don't want to get into that. It's certainly polite. And right out from under us, these definitions are changing, and we no longer know what's right and good. And we no longer know what's economically feasible and what's just a lie. And I'm making the claim that these are just different names for hypocrisy, chicanery, cowardice, and thievery. This is what you and I have to be afraid of. You have to be afraid of being so polite and delicate and decent that people pull the wool over your eyes and march you off to the pit, because it's happening all over the world, and this is what we live in. The solution, Diane says, what in the world do we do? And what we do is create gridlock, starve the beast, audit the Fed. Absolute government will swallow as fast as you can give it if you don't stop it in its tracks. Every time there's a bond measure before your community, vote it down. Every time there's a levy, even though it sounds decent to support the school, even though it's a delicate subject to talk about creating this or that or the other thing, you have to learn to say no. It stops today. I cannot allow my children's future to be sold down the pipe for something that sounds good. How about Obamacare? Does Obamacare sound good to you? Oh, great. Who's going to pay for it? The generation that doesn't even have $1,000, doesn't even have a savings account? They're not going to pay for it. Who's going to pay for it? Somebody's going to have to dole up. You don't get something for free, do you? Maybe you do. Tell me I'm wrong. Tell me free lunches exist. They do exist. They exist right there at the high school every day. Free lunch and free breakfast, guaranteed.
Summer as well.
I guarantee there's free lunches all day long at that building in that high school. Tell me where in the world did our forefathers dream this idea up, that all men are created equal, and thou shalt be endowed with three meals a day? Right? What happened to life and liberty and the pursuit of your own happiness? Your risks are your reward. Your rewards come from your own risks. Is that we've lost our constitutional footing. It's time we said no. And if you're not willing to say no, then I've got to ask, well, what are you going to do? Because there's no stopping this train. Once you let this thing out of the chute, how do you get it back? And that's what we face today. We face big, big problems. Europe faces the same problem. Municipalities in the United States of America, state governments, county governments, federal government, not only here, but in Italy, in Portugal, in Spain, in Greece, in Ireland, throughout Belgium, in Hungary, in Slovenia, all of these countries are being overrun with this socialist mantra that says, hey, free is good. Let it be free. And somebody's going to have to pull up their shorts and say, wait, I've got one cow. Her tits are run, teats, excuse me, right? They're sore, you know? I'm putting balm on them. And she can't give any more milk. What do you do? Do you just shoot her and eat her? And then what do you do next week? This is no way to run a system. And that's what you and I are being told, the lie that there's always more where that came from. The public's good for it. Just go ahead, grab a hold of those and pull. She'll give a little. I don't think so. You've been fed a lie. You become a dependent. You become a slave. You're now indebted to your master, and your master is not our Lord. Your master is the state. Until you're willing to say, no, enough is enough. It all stops here. You and I don't have a chance. Any questions as we think through these ideas? Yes, Diane.
Well, I wanted to remind you that you didn't get into American Lands Council in terms of an interim step of taking back our control.
Right. So the slide way back on that FLIPMA slide where I showed the Federal Land Management Policy Act and whatever, the slide that I took out just because I knew we were short on time was American Lands Council. Go to AmericanLandsCouncil.org. And what they're suggesting is we take our rights back by getting our land back. Federal government policy is purposefully destroying our land. And what we should be doing is purposefully taking back our land. They did it in Hawaii in 1959. We can do it in Oregon in 2015, 2016. Take our land back. That will provide the economic resources that we need to create jobs and industry and keep our forests alive, not only for the next generation and the wildlife and the watershed, but keep our forests productive because right now they're purposely getting destroyed. So thank you, Diane.
Also, there's business cards from American Lands Council back there as well.
Do you want the micro?
Well, I was just going to say that people can pressure or comment to their county commissioners, city councils for that matter, state legislators to get behind this, because it is something that's been presented in many, many town halls. You were one of the first commissioners in Oregon to push for it at the county level. So if we, it's something that we can do as citizens in our, you know, communities, because it's hard to, how do you attack the federal debt? But you can do this and get behind American Lands Council and that movement here in Oregon.
And the important thing is shrink the federal government. Stop the machine. Stop that tank by draining. Remember, I had a tank in my mind's eye. Did you guys see the tank as it was going down Main Street? Could you see it as clearly as I could see it? You don't act like you could. Drain the fuel. What did Rommel, how did we stop Rommel in North Africa? How did we stop Germany when the boys went on to Normandy? Do you know that story? We stopped them by, first of all, taking out infrastructure. We blew up their railroads. We blew up their ports. We blew up their weather stations to keep them in the dark. My suggestion is gridlock the federal government by not complying with their idiocy. Nullification is a great book and a great video on the back. Pick up Nullification and read about it. You cannot, you don't have to, it's the moral high ground to not comply with their idiocy. They have no jurisdictional authority. And you can get some books and videos right back there that describe. Additionally, we've got American Lands Council t-shirts. We've got some books. Do we have the Where Do You Draw the Line book? Is it back there? Where Do You Draw the Line is a great documentary produced. It's a book created by Ken Ivory of the American Lands Council. It's a great material. We have to tap the roots of liberty by investing our time and energy and getting people to go, holy cow, we can't do that, can we? And the answer is no, you can't. And stop people right where they stand. Stop them with knowledge, stop them with information. That one video, this dirt road economist thing went by over and over and over and over. Can you remember what the slide said? It said, tyrants love what? Ignorance and vice. For liberty can only prosper with knowledge and virtue. That's where we find ourselves today. Tyrants love ignorance and vice. Then let's snatch those two items right out from their nose and fill our community, fill our culture, fill our schools with knowledge and virtue instead. That's the way out. It takes place in the human mind, it takes place in the human heart, and that's where we make a difference. Yes?
Dennis, one of the greatest travesties that is happening right now is happening to our children that have done so well in school that we tell them, go to college and you can get a good job. Guess what? They turn those grants that they had for colleges into loans. If you go to any state college, it'll be $30,000 a year, 4 years to get a degree. If you don't get a degree, it doesn't count. That debt has to be paid back by the student. It goes on their credit rating. And you know who's going to pay for it? The parents. Because they say, we're the richest generation. You want your kids to go to school? You said it earlier. They can't pay for it. There's not jobs for all those kids.
Yeah, you're right.
The borrower will become the lender's slave. The borrower, our children and our grandchildren, that we want to get an education. This is the best way I know of right now of getting education, is to listen to someone that has done all the work and the studying and presenting us with the book and the ideas and letting us decide for ourselves how we can change to become what we need. So we can teach our children.
Right, right. I'll give you, any of you, if you have a good relationship with your children and their grandchildren are, you know, getting ready to go into school, maybe are into school, I don't even care where they are in the school system, yank them out. Homeschool them, get them into private school, do anything you can to get them out of the public school system. Because tell me what tyrants love again? They love ignorance and vice. The public school system is an arm of the legislature. The legislature is a modern day tyrant. Don't fall for they want your kid to get a good education. Joyce, is that your name? Joyce said it so clearly. They are being sold a bill of goods. They are not being taught knowledge and virtue and wisdom. Those things aren't on the platter. They're being served ignorance and vice. And the tyrants in power think this is cool. Keep them impoverished, keep them dependent, keep them right where we can best abuse and use them. That's where we want the public to be. And we are the community that can change that. We are the community that can say, we're stopping the machine, we're draining the tank of the tank. It didn't work quite so well, but I'm glad you guys knew what I was trying to say. We've got to drain this thing or it will consume our life and our livelihood. And we've got to say no more. Stop right there, no more. And it's a tough, tough road. DirtRoadEconomist.com is my website. I publish a newsletter. There's a pad and pen back there. You can sign up. I'll get I publish kind of once a week, a couple of times more than once a week. We would be more than happy to help give you information so that you have the knowledge to make a difference in your neighborhood. It's got to happen at the neighborhood level, and we need your help. So any other questions or thoughts? Diane had an item, and Colby?
The financial amount at birth, is that based on current, and this is just a random question, obviously, is that based on current population growth, or is that based off of just a generalization?
Yeah, it's a general number. Actually, you can do the math if you've got a phone, right, and turn it sideways because it's a giant number and you need 12 zeros, right? So 19,800,000,000,000,000,000 divided by 310 million, the number of population members of the United States of America, and you'll get the per capita amount that's owed. Now, the scary thing about per capita is it's all of us who are 50 plus. It's everybody in their 40s, everybody in their 30s. It's every two-year-old. It's every 6 months old. It's every eight-year-old and every 12-year-old. It's per capita. It is a gigantic number. And it is a shame. This is the shameful policy of the federal government. And we've got to say no. It's up to us. It's up to your county commissioner. Diane mentioned we were one of the first communities. Klamath Falls County Commissioners had a proclamation where we supported the American Lands Council's initiatives to create momentum for transferring public lands to the state government. The county, Jackson County, followed in our footsteps. They took our wording almost verbatim. Were you a member of the commissioners?
I think it was in December.
Yeah, just they wanted to take a feather out of Colleen's hat and stick it into their own. So they got it through just before she became a commissioner, because they knew she was dead set on supporting this also. And they took our wording and used it verbatim and are now another member county for the American Lands Council, and taking our economic resources back is one of the most important things we can do. Another question, thoughts, ideas, suggestions? You want to, let's see. Oh, I had another, I had some ideas. I want to thank you, Sam and Thad, for sharing with us. The stewardship model that is guiding our stewardship policy today is upside down, and they see the access. One of the items that they brought up was the stewardship logging went to one firm, and that one firm then divvied up to all their friends and family and no good brother-in-laws, etc. That is because Congress set it up that way. Stewardship model used to get split among county governments, so your county could support law enforcement and your county would have school funds if they needed, or road funds if they needed, or anything. It actually went into general fund coffers of your county government. Today, under the stewardship model, it goes to the contractor. So if the contractor's, Sustainable Northwest, or the contractor's, what's the conservation group? My mind just went blank. Yeah. Anyway, the money doesn't get shared, quote unquote, with county government anymore. It goes straight into the contractor's pockets, because, quote, he's an NGO, a non-government office, and he also is a, quote, non-profit. Then he gets all of those economic resources. And as a nonprofit, that just means I make a bunch of money and my poor company didn't make any money because I got it all. And we came out the year end and didn't have any profit. Oh, for shame, for shame. So this is a terrible policy stroke by the legislature to keep you in harness. And now that you're in harness, I got the reins, you got a bit in your mouth, I got the reins in my hands, I know exactly where we're going, and you don't have a say in the matter. So, important point. The upside down idea of the stewardship model and the tomatoes and the herd was a great illustration. And I have a question just for you. When you're thinking about global warming, is it anthropogenic global warming or not? I have two questions for you. One, was North America ever colder than it is today? Was it ever under like 7 feet of ice? Anybody know, you know, from your science book, was it? It was. Yeah, have you ever been to Yosemite Valley in California and seen, you know, Mirror Lake and all of that stuff? That all was under ice. It's beautiful today. It wasn't then. It was just picking cold. How about this question? Has the Earth ever been warmer than it is today? The picture in your mind is kind of fireball Earth, slowly cooling, slowly getting a mantle, slowly. And it was warmer. Did man do something to make it cooler? No. Did man do something when it was cold to make it warmer? No. So what makes us think that if man is involved in global warming, global cooling, or whatever, he could actually make a difference in the cyclical nature of what's happening on planet Earth? Is it solar flares? Or is it, you know, Al Gore flying his jet around? Take your pick.
You better not drive a diesel pickup.
Yeah.
You better not drive a truck. But by golly, I'll burn your home down. I'll burn hundreds and hundreds of thousands of acres. And it's okay.
But you also can't have a wood stove because of
this. Yeah.
You can't have a wood stove.
Yeah, wood stove and PM 2.5 is a big issue in Klamath Falls. And the tonnage of pollutants that come out of a forest fire, you know, just...
Or an uncontrolled burn.
Uncontrolled, yeah.
Or a uncontrolled burn.
But you've got to have your catalyst in your wood stove.
That's right.
It makes it all better.
You bet. It'll be all better if you just follow our rules. And pay us the permitting fee. And pay our friends who make the catalytic converter. Because they're an industry that's in our pocket. So I'll tell you a little bit about the background. People are going to get up and head out. Diane and I have lived off the grid for 20 years. No electricity coming in from any agency or public utility. And because of that, there's no tax subsidies either. So the federal government and state government haven't encouraged us to be independent. We are independent because we choose to be. I'll let you also know that we homeschooled our children, and my children are great freedom fighters and lovers, just like all of you, and we are proud to have been here today. Thank you for your great time. Thank you.
Kevin's going to take it from here.
Who has not heard of Agenda 21? Not heard of Agenda 21. Okay, so I figured that, and I was prepared for that. Debbie was kind enough to ask me to cover this topic in 15 minutes, Deb. Thank you very much. Try finding a video that is less than an hour on this topic, okay? So that's a challenge we have here. Does everyone have a handout? Highly recommended videos that if you have time and interest, please go through, and I think that you'll get a tremendous benefit by finding these on YouTube by typing in the keyword. I want to go down this list because these are the subject matter experts that I have found. There are others, but these in particular, Rosa Corey, she's out of Santa Rosa. She's the author of Behind the Green Mask. Excellent speaker. In fact, she defines what Agenda 21 is in very simple terms. It is the blueprint for the inventory and control of resources. All resources. All property. All humans. In the world. So this is a scope that we're talking about. It reaches and it touches each of us. So, Michael Shaw, this is all very self-explanatory. I've included their websites, respectively. John Anthony, we're going to go through here. Here's Rosa Corey.
You're in the...
Am I in the way?
Yeah. Good, come over here.
All right. See, this is what I wanted to do. I wanted to point you to these speakers because I'm like a facilitator to get you into YouTube and find these people. Freedomadvocates.org, excellent resource. All kinds of legal research is on this website. John Anthony, if you have a political candidate and if you'd like to vet them, that is to see if they're qualified for your vote, ask them what they know about Agenda 21. This is an excellent speaker for candidates to get them up to the level where they need to be. Tom DeWeese, of course. He has a very comprehensive video course online, and I take it everyone's seen this map. Has anyone not seen this map? Okay, this is the Wildlands Project map. It includes biodiversity, okay, anyway. And the gentleman, the speaker that I'm about to put up on the screen is the gentleman who created this map. He gathered the information to create a multi-layered map of the designations of these lands. Core reserves, corridors, little to no human use. Buffer zones, highly regulated use. We're seeing this. I'm hearing the presentation. This is a common thread. Sustainable. Is it sustainable? You know, the diesel trucks, not sustainable. They just go down their list of what is politically correct with regards to the environment.
As well as, I would say, as they're burning out rural America, that agenda is to push you into cities via this. I mean, you can't ignore it anymore because
correct.
We know there's a solution and it's never happening.
Correct.
So their solution is to burn us out, move us
into that's city. Right, stack and pack.
It is.
You'll hear that. And they call that sustainable. So here is Dr. Michael Kaufman. I'm going to put up his video shortly. He has two books that he's written. And this is a screen capture of a portion of his presentation prior to what I'm going to show here. I wanted to bring your attention to what we can do. Coordination. He mentions coordination. It kind of goes along the lines of nullification. It touches upon the 10th Amendment. So, here's Fred Kelly Grant. He is a subject matter expert, the godfather, if you will, of coordination. So if you start there, americanstewards.us, there's his website. Okay.
Agenda 21 is a 40 chapter document that literally stands out and controls every aspect of human life. Every aspect. I can't overemphasize that point. The government will control every aspect of your life if this thing is installed. It's a soft law, it doesn't have the power of law, but it was written by the International Union for the Conservation of Nature. I mentioned that last night in my talk. They've developed smart growth, biodiversity, global warming, and what is it? The purpose of the IUCN is to promote alternative models for sustainable communities and lifestyles based in what? Eco-spiritual practices and principles to accelerate our transition to a just and sustainable future. Environmental justice, this is its root, this is where it came from, is the IUCN. Humanity must undergo a radical change in its attitudes, values, and behavior, and in response to this situation, a new global ethics is taking form and is finding its expression in international law. Why? Because the IUCN writes all the international environmental treaties. What does sustainable development really mean? Well, a guy by the name of Stephen Rockefeller had taken this out of the Club of Rome and shepherded it through the IUCN into the United Nations and into a treaty and the Earth Charter, which we stopped from being accepted by the United Nations in 2002. I won't get into that very much. Michael mentioned it. But it is a new religion. Believe me, if we hadn't stopped it in 2002 in Johannesburg, South Africa, we would have a world religion right now. And backing that rural religion would be a new treaty called the Covenant on the Environment and Development that would put teeth, legal teeth, to everything that I've been talking about. But we stopped it so far by the hand of God. That's all I can say. But anyway, Stephen Rockefeller, the son of Nelson Rockefeller, governor of New York State, very, very New Age pantheistic believer, said this. This is how he's defined it. This is the end game, by the way. For all the sustainable development that you're seeing the definition of sustainable development as well, and do something stupid today that's going to deny future generations, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. That's their public definition. This is their private definition. This is their end game. This is where they're going to take us. Sustainable by definition means not only indefinitely prolonged, but nourishing, as the earth is nourishing to life and the self-actualization of persons and communities. Whoa. What is this communities? Communities has a dual meaning, and I'll show you what that is in a moment. But the self-actualization is obviously very New Age, and it goes on to say that the word development need not be restricted to economic activity, but can mean the evolution. Evolution, by the way, is an alternative word for that is reincarnation, as you will see in the next quote. The evolution, unfolding, growth, and fulfillment of any and all aspects of life. What does he mean by life? It's not what you and I look at it as. This comes out of the United Nations Global Biodiversity Assessment. I'll talk more about that in a few minutes. But it's one of the documents that we're trying to get out of the UN that we were able to use to stop the ratification of the treaty. I'm taking it out of context a little bit here because I want to see, have you see this definition. Traditional or pantheistic societies, that's another name for traditional, is pantheistic societies. Pantheism, by the way, is the belief that nature is God. Very simple definition. Societies tend to view themselves as members of a community. Okay, there's that word community. Now, so what do they think about it? Not only includes other humans, but other plants, animals, as well as rocks, springs, and pools. So these inanimate, non-living entities, to you and I, are members of your community that you have to be able to support. So you shouldn't be graveling your driveways if you live in a rural area, because you would be driving over and crunching members of your community. But they're very, very, very serious about this, folks, much as the radical Islamists are about Islam. And they're implementing this on you and I without really telling us what they're doing. People are then members of a community of beings, living and non-living. So that rock is actually a being. If you believe in reincarnation, you can see it. Because rocks will reincarnate into living entities, eventually, into, if their karma is good, into human beings. Humans, if their karma is good, will evolve into ascended masters. This is where they're taking us. We heard last night where environmentalism almost acts like a religion. Folks, it is a religion. And I have many quotes to prove that. The United Nations has three advisors. One is the World Resource Institute for Nature, or Institute. One is the World Wildlife Fund for Nature, and one is the IUCN. The IUCN created the other two in the 1970s, so that people it would not stand out. It would not be really noticeable. But it's the big mother of them all. Who belongs to the IUCN? Well, guess what? The United States Environmental Protection Agency, U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, the National Park Service, U.S. Forest Service, NOAA, NASA, you name them. They're all members. As well as ICLEI that Michael talked about, Sierra Club, Nature Conservancy, National Wildlife Federation, National Audubon, the National Resources Defense Council, Environmental Defense Fund, and so forth. 700 of them. As well as the United Nations Environmental Program, the United Nations Development Program, UNESCO. Now, they get behind closed doors. It's not open to the public. You and I can't attend. And it's not open to the media. It's totally behind closed doors. And they develop, basically, their eco-spiritual agenda as to what they're going to apply and impose upon you and I. And they've done a brilliant job of it. So many of the things over the last 30 or 40 years have come out of the IUCN and you had no clue. Being brought to us by our federal agencies with a collaboration with our non-governmental environmental organizations. It is diabolical. Now, Agenda 21, this 40-chapter document, basically, as Michael indicated, was brought out to the world. It was actually being developed over the last 20 years prior to that within the IUCN. In 1992, at the Earth Summit in Rio de Janeiro, President Clinton created the President's Council on Sustainable Development the following year. And in 1996, Sustainable America was written. And immediately after that, seven major sub-documents of Sustainable America covering our economy were written that now every federal agency is now implementing. Many of you who have had experience in natural resource management and so forth, all of a sudden our federal government changed radically in the late 1990s. For the timber management, the Forest Service, our national cut, allowable cut, was slashed in half and then slashed in half again to meet these new terms. Why? Because the new mission statements for every federal agency is no longer to support the American people in doing a good job in producing products and so forth. It was now designed to stop the American people from harming the environment. As simple as that. And everything was redirected. Highway monies were redirected to high-speed rail and light rail. Every segment of our economy, every basic contract with the United States government through whatever federal agency, every grant that was given by a federal agency to a local community has Sustainable America strings attached to implement Agenda 21, because Sustainable America was written to implement Agenda 21. I forgot to mention that of the 25 members of the President's Council, and you can get all this on the internet, it's right there. The 25 members of that, 12 of those members were members of the IUCN. They had this thing controlled from beginning to end, and not one vote in Congress, nothing. And we are suffering dramatically as a consequence. Upon receiving the report, the President asked us to begin implementing our recommendations. And the approach was used by local and regional levels. The council worked in partnership with the federal government to support efforts of the U.S. Conference of Mayors and the National Association of Counties as they created the Joint Center for Sustainable Communities in 1996, just as Michael had alluded to. All of a sudden, it was rammed right down to the local government. And the COGS and so forth that he mentioned are very much implementing this right now. That's how it got in so effectively without us understanding or being even aware that it was happening. The recommendations are comprehensive, addressing everything from economic and regulatory policy to natural resource management, from strengthening communities and education to population consumption and international leadership. These things have teeth to them, folks. If you get out of line, you don't get any federal funding. In 1993, basically, even before this was implemented, this is an internal working document of the EPA. It was in every federal agency in some form or another, and it says the Natural Resources and Environmental Agency should develop a joint strategy to help the United States fulfill its existing international obligations, in other words, the Convention on Biological Diversity and Agenda 21. Well, President Bush signed Agenda 21 when he went down to the Rio Summit in 1992. But the Convention on Biological Diversity he signed, but it had not yet gone to the Senate for ratification. And here they were implementing it. Federal bureaucrats were implementing international law without it even being ratified by the Senate. And it even gets worse than that. The executive branch should direct federal agencies to evaluate national policies in light of international policies and obligations, and to amend national policies to achieve international objectives. without one vote being taken in Congress. Unbelievable. You know the fastest way out of the dilemma we're right now? Slash the federal government by half and then slash it again by another half. President Harding did this in 1921 because Wilson left us a huge depression. It's called the Forgotten Depression because the liberals and the progressives are trying to bury it. But he got rid of that depression in a year and a half. Obama has had 4 years now, and he is still bogged down, and it's only going to get worse. I think we've seen the peak just last month, and it's going to start going downhill again because he's using the wrong method, using Keynesian economics, which will fail every single time. Keynesian, yeah, thank you. Smart growth. I'm going to go through this fast. First one was actually Portland, about the same time the Santa Cruz that Michael talked about last night began to implement it, and they established an urban growth boundary. Now, what does this look in reality? They basically zoned agricultural land into developable land, and all of a sudden that land went from, let's say, $10,000 an acre at that time up to $100,000 to $200,000 an acre. And this is what it looks like from the air. On one side, you have land that's worth hundreds of thousands of dollars today. On the right, you have land that may be worth $20,000 today.
Where is this?
This is in Portland, Oregon. And whoever draws that line has tremendous political power because he can tell his friends what land is going to be within that boundary and what's going to be without. And it happens all the time. Everything that this sustainable development does open the doors wide open to corruption. Now, what does it do? Real family mean income for Portland stayed pretty constant, but this is what happened to real housing prices. Increased by 300% because of smart growth. It's not the only one. In the Institute for Economic Research at Harvard University, basically, those cities in the country that have still natural zoning, the land is worth maybe $30,000 to $40,000 per quarter acre lot. In those areas, like San Francisco and so forth, that have had smart growth the longest, the land is worth up to $600,000 a quarter acre lot. And it's all due to regulations, all of it. It is breaking the back of average homeowners and so forth because they cannot afford these. The relative housing price index for those areas that are in smart growth when we had the housing crash in 2007 lost the value the most. Those who basically had no smart growth did not suffer nearly as much. Everything about smart growth is bad. Everything. Just take that back to your city council when they're considering these things and just say it's a mess waiting to happen if we get into this. Every study that's ever been done shows this is the dumbest thing that we could possibly do. Now, finally, the Wildlands Project, and I'll go through this quickly. He's coming up with his shepherd hook. The United Nations Convention on Biological Diversity was introduced in 1992. It was written by the IUCN in 1981. It was only an 18-page treaty. Basically, it was explained by the United Nations Global Biodiversity Assessment, one of the most anti-human documents ever published by a government entity. It was shocking when I read this the first time. The United Nations Biodiversity Assessment starts out by saying this: the Western worldview is characteristic of large-scale societies heavily dependent upon resources brought in from considerable distances. It is a worldview that is characterized by the denial of the sacred attributes of nature, which became firmly established about 2,000 years ago. Well, what became firmly established 2,000 years ago? He names Judaism and Islam, but it's Christianity. It goes on for page after page describing how Christianity is the root of all of our environmental holocaust that exists today. And you heard Michael talk about the fact that the United Nations basically every agreement that we enter into, basically it puts the government in charge of private property or control all property, and this is no exception. Property rights are not absolute, they're not unchanging, they're not unalienable, but rather a complex and dynamic and shifting relationship between two or more parties over time or space. In other words, they're whatever the government wants them to be today. But it goes on to say this, and this is one of the things that shocked me. One option for insurance against species, excessive species depletion is the allocation of private property or property rights. The reallocation of property rights implies the redistribution of assets. Well, I guess it does, doesn't it? Property rights can still be allocated to the environmental public good, but in this case, they should be restricted to usufructual. Or user, what's usufructual? I had no idea. I have a PhD and never heard the word before. It sounds like a swear word. And I looked it up in my old college dictionary that sits on my desk, or at least it used to. I use the internet now, but nonetheless, at the time, I used that old college dictionary, which was pretty ancient in itself. You won't find it in the modern dictionaries, but the college dictionary basically said that the usufruct system was started by the old Roman Empire, and it means that the Caesar owns everything. And he allocates to whom he will the rights and privileges to use that property for whatever purpose. It is horrifying to realize what they're setting up for us. You saw this in Michael's presentation. In the agricultural world in which most human beings are peasants should be able to support 5 to 7 billion people. Folks, we have 7 billion people. That means we all have to become agrarian peasants. Or, in contrast, a reasonable estimate for an industrialized world society at the present North American material standard of living would be 1 billion people. That's where they're taking us. And this is the smoking gun. To protect and recover biodiversity, representative areas of all major ecosystems in a region need to be reserved. Reserve blocks should be as large as possible. Buffer zones should be established around these core areas, and that corridors should connect these areas. This basic design is central to the Wildlands Project. We had been down to the Senate in July. We had miraculously stopped, I explained last night, the ratification in August. Just phenomenal. And then in September, when it came up again, we got a document out of the IUCN. I don't have time to explain how we did it, but nonetheless, in another miraculous move, and God has a sense of humor, folks, through a series of events, the IUCN itself sent us the document that we used to stop the treaty in the U.S. Senate from ratifying the treaty. It was astounding. And it was this quote that did it, because we had already explained to the Senate it was the Wildlands Project. And what is the Wildlands Project? Well, what you're seeing developing there, all the red areas are now wilderness, wilderness corridors, and the yellow areas are human restricted zones where only limited human activity can occur. There's not much green left, is there? That's why we need to reduce the human population to 1 billion people. It is diabolical. I can go in and spend the next half an hour explaining how they intend to do that, but I can't do that. Nope. See, the master up here is getting out his crook. It's done in by gap analysis. We stopped the treaty from being ratified, but gap analysis is now where you have digitized information, layers upon layers, hundreds of these layers, that are analyzing areas where you should be putting some of these reserves and corridors. This is where I anticipated in 1994 when I drew the map. And this is what you have now. This is what they're doing right now.
Hi guys, most of you know me here. I got the availability to travel recently to different states and see that most of the economic, most of the wildlife, most of the water, grazing, feeding, mining, anything that you can list on here is actually going on everywhere. Most of the levees that we see here, for instance, in Jackson County, when we had the levee for, Medford alone, we had the levee for the police district, the same exact things are happening everywhere. It's by design. It's not because It's just a great coincidence. It's happening everywhere. We have to start communicating with other people outside our area while we focus inside our area. Because as most of us in here know, Portland and part of the Republican Party even is not helping us. We've got our small communities, and then we've got our larger cities that pretty much dictate everything we do in the state, everything we do with land, water, anything, you name it. They're going to dictate it. The vote will be dictated by them. And we're not able to control anything. There's got to be some way, which there is, for us to do this on local. Dennis did that for a while while he was there. Colleen's trying here. But the communication isn't seen. Other states are having all the same issue, but it's not working across state lines to bring it to light exactly. Dennis brought up the FLPM. Was it Federal Lands Public Management Act, which is what, 43 USC, right? Extensions on comments from the congressional records hearings are extensively something to look into. I got the opportunity while I was up in Montana to read a lot of those and see some of the case logs that have come out of that, the Kansas versus Colorado, and I believe it was in 1907, actually. Elko City, Nevada. Everyone around the western areas had these problems, and they've combated them in small ways, and in large ways they haven't. But not growing together and working with some of those old case logs could probably be very beneficial. Simple things that were in there, like the fact that they have to hold for roads past dating, I think it was 67, if I'm not mistaken, they have to actually hold a vote in public forum if they're going to close off our roads. Anybody know this? Has anybody even heard about this? Right now, in other areas, they're taking roads back. It's a $25 in some areas and a $200 fee in another one. And that's if the roads were closed without a vote or a public forum. That's just for road closures. I think it's good to take examples from other states also. We've got other areas like Oklahoma, they're getting rid of Common Core. Did a great job with that. Other areas, they're lagging. But I think that if we continue looking in different directions at what other states are doing and kind of combine forces, it might be beneficial, which is counter to what I'm saying, that we need to work local, but at the same time, it's not. Because other people are facing these problems that we don't always have the solution someone else might have, or the resources they found. So I want to thank all of you for coming.